today once more, given all that has happened over the past few days, there is need to reiterate certain facts, certain issues. Actually, when Niranjan first brought the story to us, and we sat down, Vinod, Anant, Caravan functions as a team. The only reason that journalism actually goes on is because it's a team and organization that can make stories possible. Individuals can do a part of the work, but if there's not an organization to back it up, nothing happens. Even then, when I saw the Loya story, it reminded me of perhaps in importance, there was only one other story in my career that I'd seen or been involved with, and that story was the Radia tapes when I was with Open Magazine as a political editor. And I say that because at that time I had made the comparison, people thought it was exaggerated. I don't think anybody will say that today. And the Radia tapes actually dealt with the heart of the rot at the center of the previous UPA regime, the corruption that sat at the heart of that regime. And it dealt with three of the four pillars of government. It dealt with the political class, it dealt with the executive, and it dealt with the media. The Loya story deals with the rot at the heart of the current regime. And it has to do with communal hatred and communal violence, and it involves all four pillars, including the judiciary. And why do I say that it involves the rot at the heart of this government? It is because to come to the Sohrabuddin trial, you have to go through a series of links that connects up directly to the 2002 anti-Muslim violence in Gujarat under the watch of Narendra Modi. The first death that occurred was of Hiren Pandya, the state home minister. And that happened because Hiren Pandya supposedly was privy to certain details about how the administration acted during the 2002 violence. Questions over the Hiren Pandya death still remain unanswered. We don't know who killed Hiren Pandya. And it is the suppression of that death or questions related to that death that led to the murder of Sohrabuddin Tulsiram Prajapati. And it is in this context that the suspicious death of Judge Loya becomes so important. Because if we cannot be seen as delivering justice in this case, then the very core or basis of our democracy is under question. A judge can die in circumstances that are at best questionable without a clear answer and a clear probe being set up is just unacceptable. And a judge who's handling a case in which at that time the main accused was the BJP President Amit Shah is even more unacceptable. Niranjan has already told you the details of the story and the first story we did. And I just want to take it a little forward and say why the need for a probe today is even more urgent. Niranjan's work, excellent work, has been carried forward by a number of people, reporters like Atul Dev, Anush in Maharashtra, Suraj, RTI activist in Nagpur. And all these things tell you that the story hasn't ended today. As Niranjan had said, from the last few hours of Judge Loya's death, involve a VIP guest house in Nagpur, they involve Dande Hospital, they involve Mediterranean Hospital, and there is a postmortem at the Government College. There is a VIP guest house register which documents people who arrive and actually occupy rooms. That register, as we have shown through records, shows signs of tampering on the very pages where Justice Loya's entry should have been there. Today, through RTIs, the entire administration of the VIP guest house today is admitting that they have no record of Judge Loya's presence at all. There are mysterious entries on that pages, there are manipulations, there are dates related to 2017 on a 2014 register. in ways that cannot be mistakes. No eyewitness, as Niranjan has said, judges who were with Judge Loya have come forward. We move forward to the ECG at Dande Hospital, where supposedly Judge Loya was taken by two judges, supposedly, because we have nobody to actually tell us this is what happened. That ECG was cited by NDTV English and reproduced by Indian Express in dereliction of journalistic duty, because I have never come across any organization or any news organization that actually does investigative work where they do not even look at the date of a document they are reproducing. Attempts have been made to claim that there was a technical error in the ECG machine. Nobody has today till now explained what the technical error was or how that mistake could have been made. Then the judge reaches Mediterranean Hospital. He's, as Atul has reported, is said to be alive at that point. Another ECG is taken. That ECG has never been produced. The police conveniently produces only those records which seem to support a certain suggestion. They just turn out to be tampered. That's a different matter. But other records suddenly become unavailable. And the media houses, which are so keen to show certain things, are no longer able to provide those documents when these are asked for. Strangely enough, now all records suggest that the judge dies at Mediterranean Hospital. A zero FIR is registered at the police station that actually has jurisdiction over Mediterranean Hospital. But that FIR is strangely transferred back to a police station that has jurisdiction over VIP guest house. Why should that be the case? The doctors are saying he died at Mediterranean. The first police report is from Mediterranean. The investigation should happen where the judge is said to have died. On what grounds would the FIR get shifted after the initial FIR has been registered? So did Judge Loya die at a VIP guest house? Did he actually stay at the VIP guest house? Where was Judge Loya? Who was with Judge Loya? Why can't we find these cases out? Then we go to the post-mortem report. And since the post-mortem report has been called for by the Supreme Court, I think what we need to understand is this, as we have already said, the post-mortem itself shows signs of overwriting. It mentions the date of death, as reported by us and reproduced as the 7th, when he died actually on the 1st. And then there is a viscera report that is prepared and sent along with the, based on the post-mortem, that actually contradicts the post-mortem. So there are questions even about the postmortems. All this is happening in complete public glare with the media continuously reporting on the Loya case. What I am suggesting is all relevant documents show signs of tampering at the present moment, which is why I say that what is happening or what happened yesterday, where Anuj spoke up. Actually, Anuj did not speak up. Some lawyer spoke up for him. Anuj barely spoke. That I think if Anuj had been free to speak and free to look at the evidence, he would be convinced of what Niranjan said, that actually parts of the media are doing their job. And there are huge grounds to be suspicious, which is why later in the day, when we at Caravan spoke to Anuj's paternal uncle, the paternal uncle said, Anuj is under pressure. As a citizen of this country, Anuj's paternal uncle says, all of us need to ask for an impartial probe that brings material in front of us. In fact, I will go a step further and just end. After watching yesterday's press conference, let me, though I'm not sure I want to be in those shoes, let me put myself in the shoes of Amit Shah. Amit Shah is president of India's ruling party. He's probably the second most powerful person in the country. It is his government that controls Maharashtra. It is his government that controls the center. It would be if Amit Shah, and I'm sure Amit Shah has no reason to be afraid of the questions that are being asked related to these cases. Amit Shah should be the first person who should step forward and actually go to the Supreme Court and say that there should be an impartial probe. All records should be seized. All records should be placed. Relevant records should be placed before an impartial probe. And secondly, Amit Shah should come forward and ensure that there should be no reason for Anush to feel any pressure from any NGO. Which NGO is pressuring them? And why does Anush need the protection of lawyers when, after all, it is Amit Shah's government in Maharashtra and the center? How, under those circumstances, could Anush actually be feeling any such pressure? What I am saying is that it is not just the citizens of this country, it is not just the media. I think it is in everybody's interest, especially Mr. Amit Shah's interest, that we have an impartial probe where justice is seen to be done in this case. Thank you.